In any other year, pointing out that the Tour de France not only started but also finished would be an exercise in stating the blindingly obvious. Then along came coronavirus to make a novelty out of normality. Not that this year's Tour was ever likely to be entirely normal, but it did start, it is about to finish, and there are a couple of other things worth saying about it. It was the Tour of the Covered Face. Until it was time to roll out, or slip down, or forget, or fight off the whole idea in the excitement of getting your face on TV as a Tour de France stage winner. It was 3,484 kilometres expressed as a unit of social distance, until it was time to roll out, fall down, forget, or force the French Prime Minister into quarantine by giving him a lift, then testing positive. It was the year of the spread of dangerous misinformation.
I don't think it's going to rain, to be honest.
Of word-free commentary. And occasional straightforward honesty.
It came out that my forecast on my phone is crap.
It was the year the calendar stopped making sense. The first August opening stage in Tour history was won by a man using the race to train for the Spring Classics coming up in the autumn. Ooh-ha-hey! 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 And the second by a rider who, like many of his fans, was returning to work post-lockdown, still struggling through a bereavement.
Voilà, je voulais juste dédier cette victoire à mon papa. Ça me tenait à cœur et je suis vraiment content d'y être arrivé.
Julian Alaphilippe's father had died on June the 27th, the day the Tour was supposed to start. Alaphilippe's spell in yellow ended when he took an illegal bottle. Adam Yates, who'd come to attack and win stages, instead found himself defending the race lead, which he did pretty well, although everyone knew he was just keeping it warm for Primoz Roglic. The strongest rider had arrived with the strongest team, already in yellow, which seemed a bit presumptuous, but then they did ride as though any one of them might win the race if the leader happened to let them down.
Wow, well, Van Aert is just setting an infernal pace here.
He could probably win from here, couldn't he, Van Aert?
Sepp Kuss looking absolutely in control here at the moment. It's almost as if he was chomping at the bit before, wanting to go, wanting Van Aert to pop so he could take control.
Once Roglic had taken the slightly yellower jersey on stage 9, the only threat to the 30-year-old Slovenian winning his first Tour de France was a 21-year-old Slovenian riding his first Tour de France.
Pogacar unleashes his third attack.
Can't let him get a good gap because he is strong enough to hold it.
Pogacar takes the win!
Oh, Pogacar putting everyone in trouble behind. Only Roglic can stay with him.
Tadej Pogacar just about cracks the will of Roglic and takes the win. Pogacar battling for position and almost on the wheel, but he sees that yellow jersey go out of focus and go out of sight.
First and second, second and first. While the Slovenians fought among themselves, the Slovakian, who'd made the green jersey his own, was giving way to the Irishman, who'd had to leave his team in order to race him for it.
Bennett and Ewan Sagan trying to get on terms. Here comes Caleb Ewan alongside. Bennett holds on. Bennett holds on, and the Irishman finally gets that win.
Elsewhere, the old guard was making way for the next generation. A coach born 7 years after Alejandro Valverde directed the youngest team in the race to 3 stage wins. Although the youngest defending champion for a century didn't make it round. For those who did, the crowds at the roadside were almost as big as ever, and some of them as irresponsible. Shouting maskless into the face of your favourite rider is an odd notion of support. An empty Grand Colombier gave us a preview of what a fully locked down race might look like. Still, as Christian Prudhomme told us on day one, remove the fans from football and the setting is a drab, echoing box. Take them from the Tour, or at least ask them to stand back, and there's still France. And France in August and September seemed more than enough. Just to have a race at all seemed enough. But as we settled down for the final time trial and the last reshuffling of places behind Primoz Roglic, it was as though the race itself realised it needed to offer us something special in this of all years.
As Tadej Pogacar wins the bike race, cycling fans, you will remember the moment you saw that ride from Tadej Pogacar, because that was history being written in the present tense.
This is like images, historical images from the 1989 Tour de France.
I'll sum it up like this. Roglic has lost the Tour and Pogacar has just won it.
Ned Bolting paying an off-the-cuff homage to Phil Liggett in his famous commentary of 1989 there, on a day that stood comparison to the Tour's greatest ever finish, the one when Greg LeMond took the jersey from Laurent Fignon in a time trial on the Champs-Élysées on the final day. The loser on the ground struggling to come to terms with the blow he'd just been dealt. The man who dealt it struggling himself with the realisation that he was the instant and unchallengeable winner. The big difference across 31 years was the size of the reversal. LeMond turned a 50-second deficit into an 8-second lead, the tightest winning margin in Tour history. Pogacar took a 57-second deficit and turned it into a 59-second lead to finish the fight back he'd been staging ever since he lost a minute 21 in the crosswinds on stage 7. At the other end of his career as a Tour contender, Richie Porte, the patron saint of cycling misfortune, will finally stand on the podium in Paris, having overtaken Miguel Ángel López. It goes without saying that he lost a minute 21 on stage 7-2. Mikel Landa and Enric Mas also moved ahead of López in the time trial. He finished his sixth, with Tom Dumoulin, Rigoberto Urán, Adam Yates and Damiano Caruso completing the top 10.